This is the next video in a chapter on advanced theories of bonding. We have spent the last few videos talking all about valence bond theory and its addendum, hybridization. And now we're going to move on to the next important theory of bonding, which is called molecular orbital theory. So we'll talk about orbital phases, sigma bonding, pi bonding, and non-bonding within the context of molecular orbital theory. Let's go back to what we talked about before, valence bond theory, which was very useful and is still widely used to explain how bonding works. Valence bond theory gave us a helpful description about which orbitals overlap to give a certain geometry. That was one of the most useful parts of valence bond theory, is its use in predicting the geometry of a molecule, what shape it is, and what angle those orbitals sit at in order to hold the different electron groups. But valence bond theory can't explain everything. So we have a second bond theory to help us explain things like bond energies and why one bond may have more energy and another one. It can explain molecular stabilities or predict whether a particular molecule would be able to exist in a stable way or whether it wouldn't exist. And it can't explain something called paramagnetism. Oops, we skipped a word there, which we haven't learned about yet, but we'll talk about briefly at the end of this unit. Help explain why we need this. So this is sort of like the gaps left by valence bond theory, and we're gonna fill them with our new theory, molecular orbital theory. So a molecular orbital is just what it sounds like. It's an orbital for a molecule that covers more than one atom. So if you remember when we did orbital mixing to form hybrid orbitals, hold on, that's not how we spell that, combine. We're gonna be combining orbitals in a similar way to form molecular orbitals. And there's gonna be a few acronyms, so watch out. So we're gonna combine atomic orbitals, which we simplify as AOs. And when we combine them, they form molecular orbitals. We call MOs. And the reason we're going to do this, to combine these into molecular orbitals, is to predict electron energy and arrangements in molecules. So the energy is really a big feature of why molecular orbital theory is important, because the valence bond theory didn't tell us anything interesting about how much energy a particular electron or a particular overlap or a particular molecule had. So that's the information we're looking to get. Now, before we can talk about what a molecular orbital looks like, we need to revisit atomic orbitals just briefly, because there's one feature of the way we drew them that we left out, which is called the phase. So, side note, orbital phases. You remember that some of the orbitals we drew, like p orbitals, had different lobes. And when these orbital lobes are separated by a node, or a region of 0% probability, then these lobes are of opposite phase. So there are two phases. I think they're formally called plus or minus, but we don't really need to worry about whether a particular lobe is a plus phase or a minus phase. We just need to be aware that both of them exist. And then when we pass over a node, we are going to switch phase. It's kind of like when we tried to figure out the spin of an electron. We never knew for sure which spin an electron had, but we knew that if they were in the same orbital, both phases had to be represented. So I think this will make more sense with a drawing. So let me show you what I mean. Here are some orbital shapes that we are familiar with. There's the S orbital that looks like a sphere. There is the P orbital that looks like two balloons tied together. There are the D orbitals, four out of the five of which look like a four-lobed, four-leaf clover, three of them in between the axes and one of them on the axes. And then we have the DZ squared orbital, which is really weird looking and looks different from all of them, which kind of looks like a P orbital with a donut around the middle. So this is the way we've drawn the orbitals in the past without indicating where the phase is changed. So we're just going to change the way we draw them to indicate the phases. So starting with the S orbital only has one lobe. So there's only going to be one phase in this picture. And it doesn't matter which phase we pick. So we could draw it with one phase, or we could draw it with the other phase by drawing it, coloring it a different color. It doesn't matter. So you can either use two different colored pens to draw the different phases, or you can just have one be colored and one uncolored. That's also an acceptable way to do it if you don't have six pens lying around like I do. When we draw a P orbital, we know that P orbitals have an angular node through the middle, through that nucleus. I don't know why I didn't draw the orbital first there. There we go. So P orbitals have an angular node through the middle. And so when we pass through that node, we need to change phases. So it doesn't matter which phase we pick, we just need to make sure we change it. So if I pick the black phase for the top orbital, as I pass through this angular node, I now need to switch to the other phase for the second lobe. Or I could do it the opposite. I could put the green phase on the top, pass through a node, and switch to the black phase. So it doesn't matter which one goes on top, as long as you switch as you go over the node. So the D orbitals, remember that those have two angular nodes. There's a lot going on here. So there's one angular node that's more horizontal, and there's one angular node that's more vertical. So if we pick a lobe at random, let's pick this top left one. Every time we cross over a node, we have to switch phases. So we cross over a node if we take a horizontal step, so we'll switch to the green. And we also cross over a node if we take a vertical step down, so we switch to green. And then for the last lobe, if we move from green over a node, we're going to have black again. So whether or not you have a D orbital with the lobes on the axis or off the axis, you will always have the lobes across from each other with the same phase, and the lobes next to each other with different phases. So I could color it this way too if I wanted. It doesn't matter. And then for our final goofy boy, the DZ squared orbital, it's a little bit trickier, but I think you'll remember how to do it once you've done it once. So we'll start with the lobe on the top. And now we need to know where the nodes are. So the angular nodes, oh, we forgot to draw this one, hold on. Okay, the angular nodes in this shape is a little bit weird. It's not just a flat plane, it's actually a cone-shaped node. One on the top and one on the bottom. Not super important that you know that, but it'll help you to be able to remember how to color the phasing. So we have that top node or that top lobe, and we move over this cone-shaped node to get to the donut is going to be a different phase. And then to get to the bottom, we have to pass through another cone-shaped node, and we have the black phase again. So the top and the bottom lobes of this P orbital shaped bit are actually the same phase with the donut around the middle as a different color. And we could do it the opposite way as well. We could color the donut black and color the two balloon-shaped lobes as green. And then just for the sake of completeness, not because we actually need to talk about it, let's draw a radial node. So if we have an S orbital like that, but we have greater than a 1s orbital, and hopefully yours looks more like a circle than this lumpy blob that I have just drawn. In between the lobes of an S orbital lies a radial node, like the area between an orange and an orange peel. And so when you move from one lobe over a radial node to the next one, we have to change colors as well. Be a lot of coloring involved to show this. So we also change phases when we cross over a radial node. We just won't be worrying about those too much right at this time. So now that we can draw orbitals correctly with their phases represented, we can move on to looking at what a molecular orbital looks like and what its features are in the next video.